Hello, I'm Nigel Rain. I'm the Rebanks Family Chair in Pollinator Conservation at the University of Guelph. And tonight I want to talk to you about some of the recent work my team and I have been doing, looking at the impacts of pesticides on the behavior and ecology of essential insect pollinators, bees. So why should you care about pollinators? Well, this is a typical view of the produce section of your local grocery store. And this is the view of the same produce section of your grocery store without the pollination services of bees. So I think you'll agree that's a significant contribution to food production. About 1 in 3 mouthfuls of food that we eat are dependent on the unmanaged pollination services of bees. That equates to the majority of our fruits and vegetables and nut crops, and includes important commodities like coffee and chocolate that we all rely on. It's also perhaps less apparent from this picture that it affects feedstocks, which also feed into dairy and meat production. So overall economic value of crops reliant on pollinators is estimated to be around $690 billion per year. So it's quite a significant economic evaluation, and that is increasing. Our reliance on these pollinator-dependent crops is going up. Over the last 50 years, we've seen an increase of around 300% in the volume of agricultural production that's dependent on pollinators. So I think we'll all agree that pollinators are essential for food production. But it's not only food. The activity of pollinators is critical to support diversity of plant species and also maintaining normal ecosystem function. So this leads to a broad diversity of beautiful flowers and also the stunning pollinators that you see behind me. Something like around 90% of the flowering plant species around the world rely on insect pollinators to some extent for reproduction. But we are hearing increasingly about problems globally with pollinators. Widespread information is suggesting that we are suffering pollinator declines. We are hearing from studies around reduced species richness, losses of plant pollinator interactions, reductions in species abundance, relative abundance, and also shrinkage of species range compared to historical data. And that's obviously a source of concern. The picture of what's causing these declines is somewhat complex and is likely to be related to multiple interacting factors, and they're all likely to be important. But when we look at the public debate around pollinator declines, it's focused extensively on one of those factors, and that's the potential for pesticide impacts to have an impact on our pollinator communities. And in particular, a group of pesticides coming from a plant product, nicotine, the neonicotinoids. So even at relatively low levels of exposure to insecticides, at much lower levels than would cause lethal effects, would cause insects to die, we can have measurable impacts on the normal behavior of these animals. This might be unsurprising to you when you consider that if you have a couple of glasses of wine, that's not going to necessarily kill you, but it will significantly affect your ability to perform normal behaviors and might make it unsafe for you to drive. So we've been looking at a similar kind of thing with pollinators to think about how low levels of exposure to pesticides, as might occur in the field, might be affecting the behavior of bees and other pollinators. And our results show a wide range of behavioral impacts on individual bees and also feed into colony level functions. So bees exposed to low levels of insecticides, of neonicotinoid insecticides, choose different flowers, and critically they take longer to learn how to handle those flowers to extract nectar and pollen. They become less effective pollen foragers and on average bring in smaller pollen loads to the nest, and that's a critical source of protein to build new bees. It also may affect their ability to navigate effectively, so they may take longer to come home, or they may not return actually to the nest at all, so they may be lost from the colony going forward. And we also have recorded from work from my lab, we have seen that there are impacts on the ability of queens to establish colonies and also subsequent colony development, indicating that relatively subtle impacts of neonicotinoid exposure on individuals can have feed into colony level function. Now, my lab was the first to show that combined exposure to two different types of pesticide actually significantly raises the chance of bumblebee colonies failing totally. And that sort of combined exposure is actually quite likely to be common in farmed landscapes. Bee reproduction can also be affected by low levels of insecticide exposure. We know relatively little about this at the moment, but it could have important implications for population persistence more generally. And most recently, my team were the first in the world to show a link between impacts of individual behavior and actually the outputs of those behavior, the pollination services these bees provide to crops. So apples pollinated by bees exposed to low levels of neonicotinoid contained fewer seeds. And that is an indicator of lower quality and likelihood that those apples will garner a lower price for the farmer. So a measurable economic and food production impact of those changes in bee behavior. Going forward, we want to know more about what's happening to solitary bees that are really important. Almost everything we know about the impacts of environmental stresses, including pesticide exposure, come from studies of managed pollinators, primarily from bumblebees and honeybees. Now, these are really unusual bees in that they form colonies. So the majority of bee species, more than 95% of the 20,000 or so bee species around the world, are solitary. And they're very diverse in their behavior and their ecology, and we need to know more about how they might be affected by bees might be affected by pesticide exposure going forward. We've recently started investigating the potential for pesticide exposure and agricultural practices like tillage to affect solitary squash bees. This is a really interesting system in that the squash farmers, the pumpkin farmers, rely on these solitary ground nesting bees to pollinate their crop. And the bees that are wild populations live in the farmer's fields. They nest in and around those fields. They rely on the squash and pumpkin flowers for their food requirements, and also the males sleep in the flowers overnight. Now, this provides a really exciting opportunity for us to look at total exposure to bees across their life history. We can look at the impacts on larval development as these bees develop in the ground. We can look at impacts on the behavior of these economically important pollinators of this crop, and we can link this to reproduction and hopefully to population persistence in a farmed landscape. These bees have been flagged up as a source of concern by federal pesticide regulators, so there's interest in this at all levels, and we're really excited about this becoming a potential model, the squash bee becoming a potential model for assessing pesticide impacts on pollinators going forward for the future. Thank you.